It's Wednesday, it's 7 o'clock, it's time for Magic TV. I'm Mashi Scanlon, the guy on the left. With me this week, special returning guest, Frank Lepore. Of course, we have Darksteel Humphrey, and behind the camera, we've got our very own Magic TV intern, Big Worm Armando Benavides. Got a very interesting show this week. You know, we'll look backwards in terms of the two GPs that just happened this last weekend, GP Prague and GP San Jose, and then forward with a little standard Pro Tour preview, a limited preview, and then our Pro Tour teams retrospective. We talked a little bit about it last week with Marshall and Paul, but it was a little bit weird. You know, it's hard to talk about because, you know, Paul's on a team, so we couldn't go too deep into it, but we got you, Frank, so we can get your take on it. And then, of course, we'll have this week's Top 8. Before we dive into any of that, I want to remind you that Magic TV and all of our Magic TV Top 8s are brought to you by ChannelFireball.com. So all the cards we talk about in our previews, all the cards we talk about during this GP weekend, from Aether Revolt all the way on back to Alpha, are available right now on ChannelFireball.com. So anything that you're looking for, any accessories, any sealed product, check out ChannelFireball.com, and they should have what you're looking for. All right. How you doing, Frank?
I'm all right. Always good to be back. Like, this is, I feel like this is my home away from home now.
That's good. That's good. And speaking of home away from home, when last we checked in, you had nothing.
I had nothing. I had a box and a TV stand and a laptop.
And look at you now. Did you end up returning that? Well, you were going to return your router or whatever, weren't you?
Yes, I did. So, obviously, I got the pod earlier last week, and that had my original router and modem in it, so I just used that.
Everything's good. So I see a little, X-Files poster back here.
There's an X-Files poster, there's a Magritte poster, and there's a dog on a bed.
Yeah.
And there's a green screen right here, I could just bring it over, but there's no real point to it if it's not like...
If we're not actually projecting something onto it, it's no good, so...
Right, then it's just a green curtain behind me, so it's, there's no real point to that.
Are you
sure? I was streaming earlier, right before Magic TV, and people kept asking me what I was playing at the PT, and I was like, I won't be there because I'm at... I just moved in like a week and a half ago. I'm still dealing with like maintenance things, and so, you know, they're like flying to Ireland this week and getting adequate testing was just not a reasonable thing to do, so...
Were you able to defer till, what is it, is Albuquerque the next one?
Nashville is the next one, and yeah, as long as you have, if you're silver, as long as you have... a qualification in the queue, like it's good for whatever one you go to next.
Oh, nice. So
you're invited to one. Like, I was invited to Dublin. If I don't show up there, then I'm just invited to Nashville instead.
It just rolls over.
Yeah.
Very nice. I heard you flooded the new apartment.
Yeah. Unintentionally, I was like, hey, it's 2 a.m. I'm getting stuff done. I'm unpacking. Let me put a load of laundry in. And usually I just do my clothes on cold. But so it was like I just washing something that required hot, so I put it on hot. And like 40 minutes later, I go to the kitchen and there's like 2 inches of standing water. And I'm like, all right, the water heater broke, I guess. And so I just panicked. I freaked out. I called maintenance. It was not a good time. It was one of the lower points of my life, and that was fun to deal with. So.
2 inches of water is all it took, and you're back to the animals, huh?
Yeah, no, completely. Like, 2 inches, and I'm like, oh my god, all my possession. Like, because I was still unpacking, so I had tons of boxes, and like, as someone who reads comics and plays Magic, I have a lot of paper products.
Oh god.
There were literally like boxes and boxes, long boxes of Magic cards all over the floor, and I was like, oh, and then I started picking them up and like getting them into safe places, and I was just like, everything else be damned. And I just started like taking all the boxes and just getting them out of the water. And thankfully,
head for the high ground.
That's exactly what I was like, put them on things that are less important. I had like modern and standard boxes with play stuff in them, and I was just like, oh my god, if I was asleep when this happened, like, it would all be gone. Like, I would have lost everything.
Jeez. Well, do you have renter's insurance?
Yeah, I do. But the thing is, like, so the way it is now, like, $200 $200 of stuff was damaged. But my deductible is $500. So I'm like, well, great.
I'm just going to have to eat it. That sucks.
Yeah, well, I'm talking to the rental company tomorrow, because this was the first time I've used hot water in that capacity. And so, like, I just feel like, you know, I've literally moved into a place where the hot water heater didn't work. So it's not really, I feel like they should cover some of it at least, you know. I know. That's my feeling as well. Believe
good
me.
Luck with that, Frank.
Good luck with that is right. I agree with you.
Let's
but
Let's talk about this last weekend. Two GPs, one a little bit more eventful than the other. Let's start with GP San Jose. That was a Channel Fireball Grand Prix. Unfortunately, as we talked about just, two weeks ago, you were going to come, and then, of course, you had this move out to the East Coast. And so, change of plans, you weren't able to make it. But I was there. It was a great GP, a lot of fun. I will say this, man, pre-registered pools for sealed, I mean, they make everything better.
Oh, I imagine that's 100% accurate. Like, that seems like it's super convenient.
Have you played it? Because I know SCG's done
I don't think I have.
Wow, it's a game changer. I mean, just from the perspective of the player being able to say, I mean, we ended round 9 at 9 p.m., and normally at like a limited event, it can go 10, 10:30. Like London,
yeah.
Last year, we were done at 10:30. So that part was great. The venue was great. Of course, local GP is weird because you're in this weird position with all the judges and everyone hitting you up for like, hey, what's good around here? You're kind of hosting. You have this weird hosting thing going on. So it was a great event. For those of you who joined us, thank you so much. I'm glad you made it out there. If you have any feedback, feel free. You can tweet at me at the guy on the left, T-H-A, guy on the left. We'd love to hear any feedback you have on the event. The exciting one was GP Prague. Did you hear about this, Frank?
The fire.
Did you see the video?
I saw pictures of like smoking buildings and stuff. I don't know if I saw like an actual fire video.
It started at a food vendor stand, and someone was actually standing there because you could kind of see it and taking video of this thing. And the video is interesting because it doesn't look as bad as it ended up being. I hear like, you know, there was a fire, a wall collapsed, but they got everybody out, all the judges, all the players, all the tournament staff made it out, and kudos to Tournament Center. Because they just pulled everybody out, had to shut it down for Friday, for day zero, had to actually change halls, went to a whole new hall. All right, so standard, I'd say the elephant in the room, but it's probably more appropriate to say the cat in the room, is obviously Felidar
nice.
Guardian, and Copycat, that's what I call it. I don't know is that what everybody's called? Frank, is this deck called Copycat, or are there other names for this? Because I always
call
it
Copycat. Think that's a thing. I think people are calling it that. I just called it Splinter Twin. I'll just keep calling it Splinter Twin.
Oh, yeah, no chance for confusion there, Lepore. Oh, jeez. So,
okay, I'm just going to put this down now.
Copycat is, it looks like it's a thing. I mean, we saw the first tournament with the combo legal. The first competitive tournament with the combo legal, we saw, two or three in the top eight. This last weekend, we saw 5 in the top eight. And it looks like the only thing that has any game or that can keep up with it is some variation of either green-black delirium or just straight-up green-black aggro.
Yeah, that seems to be the case. I mean, you look at these results. Like, I think someone was even like, I've seen posts on Twitter where people are like, this is not looking healthy right now. Like, it's weird when you go from a format where like 3 cards are banned to keep the metagame healthy, and then the next 2 weeks it's like, well, 4 or 5 of the top 8 decks are combo decks, and the other 3 or 4 are like, you know, green black decks. It's kind of weird.
I mean, it really begs the question, and I mean, I think this is kind of what you're getting at, what does this metagame look like if those bannings don't happen? Is Copycat a thing if we're still in a world with Emrakul?
I think it's still a thing. I think you're just playing Reflector Mages now, right?
Right. I mean, and you know, I
and Smuggler's Copter to get your pieces.
So, is it just too good? I mean, I don't know. It seems asinine to ban those cards to keep this deck.
I was thinking that same thing. I'm like, it's going to be real awkward if they have to ban another card standard, and then there's like 4 or 5 bannings in standard in the past 6 months. Like, that's super awkward.
That has to be a huge concern of Wizards R&D. But I think if we're in a world where that happens, I think it shows that, I mean, and for old school play, how long have you been playing, Frank? You've been playing forever too, right?
Oh, like 20 years.
Yeah, so for old school players like us, like, some of these creatures you see today are so obscenely powerful. Like, if these were printed in
they're
Tempest,
real good, dude.
They would have been insane. Cards that are like fringe playable or not quite playable would be so busted in standard type 2 15 years ago. But what that's evidence of is this crazy power creep that we're seeing in standard, that we're seeing in development. And so, you know, here's a real question. Has R&D crossed the line? Because they've definitely been pushing it and pushing it and pushing it. Are they at a point now where they've crossed the line?
Here's an interesting thing. When I played Versus System back when it was like competitive and there were like PTs and, you know, 10Ks and things like that. One of the things I noticed about Versus System that was super interesting was that the commons, there were a lot more commons and uncommons that were like tournament level. And I've noticed with Magic that like I bought, I bought like the specific commons and uncommons I needed from the set. And there's not a lot. I think there's like less than 15 commons and uncommons that are like obviously playable in standard, you know? And that's not a lot at all when there's like 60 of 60 total. And it makes me wonder if like this would happen if there were more commons and uncommons that were specifically made for constructed play rather than just limited play, you know?
No, I mean, I think that's something huge to look at. I mean, yeah. Let's take, so some of the other decks, you know, right now it certainly looks like copycat and green black are at the top of the heap, right? Where do you think, I don't know, and I'm not sure how much time you've had to play or tink around with standard, where do you think like, you know, blue black control, Marvel, energy, any of the other decks in the format, where do you think they lie in this calculus?
It's a good question. I'm not even sure, honestly. It's hard to tell because they're not represented heavily right now. So you don't even see like people working or like the deck lists you see, like blue light control decks you might see right now, they're obviously not the best decks. They're not the super tuned decks. Whereas like when everyone and their brother is playing like Copycat, you know, or Green Black Delirium, which is a deck that's been around for months, you're pretty certain that those are well-tuned lists because people have been playing them so frequently. But if you're like one or two guys that are playing blue black control, like your list is probably pretty not bad, like not bad at all, but like probably pretty like unhoned, you know, like not it's in its infancy, I would like to say. So it's hard to say like where those decks are going to end up because people just aren't devoting the same amount of time to them, I think. Yeah.
Well, and I mean, you know, whenever you see the dominance of combo, there's always hope that control can come in because when combo's good, control's out there to be, you know, the scissors to the paper, if you will. So there must be something out there. But then when you see something that's so dominant, and this is why when one deck rises to too much prominence, it's terrible because A, it's a sign that there's something degenerate happening in the format, and B, it warps everything. It chases things out, which is why we think, you know, Reflector Mage, for instance, was out of the format because it was maybe warping things just by its presence, keeping things out. So when does it hit that point with Copycat? I'll ask you this before we move on to Limited here, Frank. How many copies of Copycat have to be in the top 8 before Wizards has to seriously make a banning following the Pro Tour?
Do you mean the PT top 8?
Yep.
I think even 4 is pretty unhealthy because this is a brand new standard format, right? Like they banned 3 cards to make sure it was diverse. And so if, like, you get to the PT and there's 4 copies of the same deck in the Pro Tour in standard, in a brand new standard format, it's kind of awkward, right?
Yeah, I mean, we know no matter what that if any deck has a bullseye on its back, it's Copycat. So it's up to the pros, right? It's up to everybody in Dublin right now who's testing. They can either find a way to break up that combo or marginalize that combo, or maybe we're being too, you know, there's a recency bias here and the deck just isn't that good. It's just what everyone's playing because it's on everybody's radar. I don't know.
Yeah.
But this is a real test of a format, of a healthy format. The best minds in Magic, minus you, of course, Frank, since you're not in Dublin right now. The best minds in Magic are right now thinking about how do they break up that combo. I mean, I think that's got to be where every...
Oh, yeah, 100%. They know what they're gunning for,
right.
You know?
Every play group in Dublin right now has a copy of Copycat that they've been playing. That they've
and
been
they're gone, 100%, yeah.
That A, they refined to make as good as they could, and then once it's completely refined, they started looking for ways to beat it, started looking for ways to break it down. So if they're successful, no banning. But if they're not, and I agree with you, I think if there are four copies of that deck in the top 8, there's going to be a real problem, and heads will roll on the B&R announcement following the Pro Tour.
It's going to be awkward, yeah. And like the thing is, like, it's easy. Like, I want to be able to keep a level head because history says that, you know, the PT results are often significantly different than the results from the week before, you know. like the SCG events leading into the PT are often completely different. So that's gives you a little faith. But the deck could just be that good, you know?
Yeah, I mean, I remember, you know, this was year. I mean, clear. I'm gonna go into the Wayback Machine here. The tournament that used to set the standard for a lot of this stuff, particularly leading up to Pro Tours, was States. States used to be a thing, and States.
Yeah, States was great.
You'd see States everywhere, and I remember the 1 year that States was unbelievable, with everyone playing the same deck was Fires. When Fires was printed, what is that, Invasion block? When Fires was printed in Invasion, God, I really hope it's Invasion. And this is what happens when you get old, kids. You start forgetting what sets Magic cards came out in. It was everywhere. It was like four or more in the top eight of every States tournament everywhere. And, of course, I think it was, God, I want to say Pro Tour Chicago was immediately.
Are we talking about Fires?
Yeah.
Yeah, oh, Fires is miserable.
Yeah, and everybody was playing Fires. So sometimes, you know, and that was not a common thing, you know. So sometimes you get that pre-Pro Tour metagame and it's complete trash and the pros come in and just eviscerate it. And sometimes it's like, okay, no, that's right. We're all playing that. So could totally happen. Make the call right now before we jump to Limited, Frank. Is Copycat the real deal? And will we see multiple copies of that combo in some form, be it Jeskai, be it 4-color, whatever version, some version of the Saheeli Rai, Felidar Guardian combo in multiple decks in the top eight of Pro Tour Aether Revolt?
Yes, I think we're definitely going to see some copies of it. The problem with the deck is that it's just good. Like, it doesn't really need the combo. It just has the other just like strong Jeskai cards or strong 4-color cards. Like, it doesn't need the combo to like. It doesn't live and die off of the combo, right? It's just a good deck that has a combo in it, which is always a little scary. Like Splinter Twin. Like Splinter Twin could, you know, if they get the combo on turn four, it's great for them. But they can always grind you out because they're just a solid control deck.
Yeah, I completely agree with the sentiment. I actually think that Copycat is the real deal.
It seems good.
And it does seem good, and the combo is solid. So, you know, sometimes you get these combo decks that are so fragile. And, of course, there's always a way to disrupt a combo deck. That you know, it's not like there aren't cards out there that can disrupt every combo deck. It's just a matter of how solid it is, how resilient it is. Having access to blue is huge, obviously, because you're able to protect your pieces.
Yep.
So, you know, what it comes down to now for this metagame, for instance, is green-black. Does green-black have what it takes to fight through either the Copycat combo or whatever else gets brewed up? You know, do you expect any Delirium or green-black aggro in the top eight?
Yeah, it's the same thing. Like, I think those decks are also just very good. Like, they're just black-green Delirium and black-green aggro are just, they're kind of middle of the road, and, like, they're not doing anything super fancy. They're just strong decks with strong cards, you know, so I wouldn't be surprised to see them. But, like, the Saheeli decks actually scare me a little bit because they're decks where, like, if you tap out, you can just lose on the spot.
That's true.
And that's a weird – that's a scary place to be in Standard. That's kind of, like, more of a modern thing or, like, a legacy thing, you know?
I completely agree. No, that's great. Yeah, it's been a long time since you've been scared to tap out in Standard. But this,
yeah, because, like, you want to keep Shock up to kill the Saheeli after they activate it or something, you know? Like, you want to have – you don't want to threaten a way to stop the combo, but if you tap out, they're just like, all right, kill you.
Yep, and you're dead. If you were forced to play Copycat in Dublin this weekend, would you go 4-color or Jeskai?
I would probably go 4-color, but I think the correct answer might be Jeskai.
Yeah, that's janky, dude. You got to go Jeskai there. I would go Jeskai. I would not
right,
go 4-color. Yeah.
But I like playing crazy stuff, so if you can get some cool green cards in there, you know, I'm going to not mind.
True. God, someone in the chat actually asked what Fires was. So
that just means we're old. That's all.
That's my moment to feel old. I was like, wow. I mean, there was a time when it was just like that tech was everywhere.
Fires of Yamai was best suited with Sapperling Burst. So if you want to look up Sapperling Burst and Fires of Yamai, that was usually the combo. You just make a bunch of dudes attack with a million guys.
You could go lethal. You could go with Fires and Burst, you could go lethal. In fact, could you go 15 or could Blastoderm was lethal with a Fires out, wasn't it? What's the fading on it?
By itself, Blastoderm can deal 15, but if you get the haste, it can actually deal exactly 20.
Yeah, yeah. So, I mean, there were a lot of ways that Fires made it ugly. So, I wish we could just talk about Pro Tour Chicago, man. I know a lot about that.
Well, we have to get our canes first and our
seriously,
glasses.
People are like, what car? Blastoderm?
Wait, is that back that in my day, our creature said shroud, not hexproof. You kids don't know how good you have it.
It's so true. It's so true.
All right. You could target our creatures with anything.
I mean, the cards that were played, the creatures that were played in that era era are so subpar compared to this.
Oh, man. I'm like, well, Blastoderm, a 5/5 for 4. It has shroud.
It was unbelievable.
Oh, but it dies in 3 turns.
I mean, and there was a huge debate. Rith the Awakener versus Two-Headed Dragon. I mean, can you imagine?
How could you even decide?
They're so subpar right now. Right? Anyway, all right. Let's talk about some limited. Frank, you said you had a chance to jam some drafts on Moto. You doing that on stream or what?
I just started streaming again today, so you can find me on twitch.tv/Frank Lepore if you guys are interested.
And what did you get a chance to stream today?
I did a league, and I went a very solid 0-3. That was pretty sweet.
Yeah.
I have not gotten this draft format down at all yet, so I'm looking forward to, like, learning it and figuring out what's good and what's not, but I'm not there yet, so.
Any lessons, any nuggets yet? I've heard green, some people say green's pretty good in the format.
The green cards are good. Yeah. 100%. Yeah, the green cards are great. Like, I think there's a lot of subtlety in this set. Like, and it's the people who pick up on that faster are going to be better rewarded. There's a lot of misleading stuff too. Like, there's the there's a card called Death something or other. It's a white instant. It's 4 mana and it deals 3 damage divided any way you choose among an attacker or blocker. And like, I thought it was great. I'm like, this is a great removal spell. You know, it's 3 damage and you can divide it among like servos or whatever. But it's like really hard to keep 4 mana up turn after turn after turn and then like profitably get this in. So it's like, it's a card that like I've learned that I took high, but now I've learned that it's not that great. So,
wow. All right.
Yeah, Ridge Scale Tusker, someone mentioned in the chat, which is it's a 5/5 for 5, and it puts a counter on every single other creature you have. And I'm just like, this card is insane. This should be a mythic.
Oh, it should be a mythic, please. Grow up.
It's better than Blastoderm, dude.
Not possible. Not possible. That card was such a beating.
I mean, doesn't even have Shroud.
It was too good. We could talk about it more in our top 8. I don't want to give any spoilers, but my honorable mention, well, if I definitely would apply to Blastoderm. All right.
You have your own honorable mention?
Of course. Did I have multiple honorable mentions?
Good. I thought
See,
I was just going.
Everybody, you ask Frank right now because Frank was there. Frank is in the Magic TV chat. He can attest the fact I get no respect. No respect in the chat. People just ignore all my suggestions. Don't want to hear what I have
you.
To say. But you will hear my thoughts on that.
You will listen to me.
Yeah. Somehow we're like arguing about this and Frank say, "Well, I don't know, sounds good to me." Oh, end of argument? Oh god. Scary. That's a scary thought. Lepore chimes in, says it looks good, and we can all go on with our lives. So any other thoughts on limited? Have you done any sealed?
The only sealed I did was a pre-release. I did 2 pre-releases, and we talked about that last time, but I didn't get the impression that the sealed was that much different than the draft. You know, like there's not like, I don't know, super differences. But I mean, like I said, I'm still learning the draft format. So ideally, we're going to do better than 0-3 tomorrow, which would be nice.
So you streaming tomorrow again?
Now I'm going to start streaming regularly again. So that should be nice to get that back up and going. Because, dude, I had like, I lost like 50 subs between the month I was like down moving and getting everything set up. So I was like, oh my God, this is so sad.
Yeah, we'll get back up there. So what time can we all tune in and watch you stream tomorrow?
I usually start streaming around, when I was in Seattle, I streamed at 2 p.m. So I started today at around 5 p.m. Eastern time. So around 2 p.m. Pacific time is probably accurate.
Okay. Very nice, very nice. So all you guys tune in, watch Frank as he just totally bombs drafting, and you can feel good about yourself because like, hey, I'm better than that. I did better than that in FNM. So, you know.
Well, my mantra as for as long as I've been a Magic player is that you can learn as much from losing as you can from winning. So.
Yeah, you keep telling yourself that. Hey, man.
It's been working so far.
While you're struggling through this format, I just want to drop this little nugget on you. There was a 6-year-old, Dana. She's a 6-year-old.
I saw the pictures of that.
Yeah. You know what her record was day one of the Grand Prix?
I hope it's real good. Tell me.
I mean, better than I did because I dropped one. She went 4-5.
For a 6-year-old, that's actually pretty solid.
I mean, four people lost to her. I mean, come on.
Yeah.
That's insane. So, I mean, she was talking about what her goals are. Like, her goals are, like, to day two a Grand Prix. 6 years old, she's like, I would like to day two a Grand Prix.
All she had to do was win two more rounds, and she would have done that. That's insane.
I mean, can you believe that? God bless her, man. I would love... She is going to do that. She's going to day two a Grand Prix, and it's going to be one of the greatest moments. You know, I was going to say in kind of Grand Prix history, in Magic history, this six-year-old girl day twoing a Grand Prix, she's coming to Vegas.
Oh, yeah.
So hopefully, she, I mean, it's going to be awesome. I think she said she would do Vegas. She and her father were there, and they would join us in Vegas and Phoenix. So hopefully between those
nice,
two
more shots,
she can find a way to day two. So that will be awesome. I think she prefers Constructed, too. So this was her first limited event, and she 4-5'd it. So
that's crazy because you have to like build a deck in limited, right? Like,
yeah,
that's not an easy skill.
Yep.
I don't know if I could build a sealed deck when I was 6 years old. I could barely do it, and I'm in my 30s.
You barely do it now.
Yeah, like this is something I struggle with weekly.
I'm just gonna put this out there, Frank. 4-5 at a Grand Prix. She might be better than Mr. 03 drop sitting next to me right here, huh, Frank?
I didn't drop from my league, buddy. It just ended, okay?
Oh yeah. I didn't drop. It ended. Sorry. I misspoke. 03 ended. Sorry.
Yeah, that's significantly different. Dropping is like I gave up and I'm just done.
Yeah.
I saw the event to its conclusion.
Sometimes you give up because it's done and you want to move on, and sometimes you just don't get the message. And you go to play round four and realize it's already over.
You're like, wait, there is no round four. I have to go do something else with my life now.
So sad. So sad. I bet you Hunter's better at draft than you are.
I don't know. He's pretty good.
Yeah. He's so uninterested in you. He's hilarious. All right. Let's talk a bit about these Pro Tour teams. So we had a great discussion at the live with a live Magic TV at Grand Prix San Jose. And honestly, like, no BS, I think it was one of the best Magic TVs we've ever done. I haven't had a chance to go back and watch it, but the audio is up on iTunes.
So I can't believe you're going to say it was one of the best Magic TVs and I wasn't even there. That's super. I can't even believe you, man.
Why do you think it was so good, bro?
Wow.
These are not unrelated occurrences, my friend. They're not.
This is not a coincidence, buddy.
It is not. The live ones are always fun because, you know, we get to holler at the audience a bit and get a little bit of reaction. Here's the reason it's so fun. We got to get you on a Magic TV with Paul, Frank, because we keep getting you on when Paul's not around.
I keep replacing Paul. I'd love to do one with the three of you guys.
Yeah,
or the two of you guys and me. So,
well, here's the deal, Frank. You come out to a Channel Fireball GP, Vegas. You're coming to Vegas, right?
I haven't made plans to do it, but I have no reason not to.
Frank,
so
it's three friggin' GPs. Come on, man. You got to come to Vegas. Come to Vegas. Is New Jersey going to come to New Jersey?
Is that us?
Are we doing Jersey?
I don't know who's doing what this year. Like, I haven't had time to look up any 2017 Magic stuff yet. Like, so
come to Jersey. I don't know. I mean, I don't know.
When is it?
It's weekend of March 10th.
I might be able to do that.
Dude, come to Jersey. We'll film a live Magic. Paul, it might just be you and me live. I don't even know if Paul's going. Come to Jersey.
Oh my God, dude. The Mashi and Frank show live.
Yeah, we'll kill it, dude. You should totally. I mean, Jersey, Vegas, Phoenix. I mean, you come to Mexico City if you want.
Let's chat after, and we'll see if we can get something going, because I really have no reason not to go to, like, Jersey.
You definitely should. It's standard, too, so, you know, you don't totally should go, but we'll do that. My point is this. The reason that live Magic TV was so good was Marshall Sutcliffe was on it, and he's freaking amazing. He's, like, the best host ever, and I'm the one supposed to be hosting it. But the best part is, you know, obviously, I was giving Paul a bad time the whole time. And I don't know how well you know Marshall. I don't know how well any of you know or follow Marshall. Marshall's like one of the sweetest, nicest guys in the industry. He is just such a nice guy. And about halfway through the show, he just started throwing these like digs at Paul. And he did it like so subtly. They were so good. And it was just hilarious. And it was just like, oh my God, even Marshall's going after Paul. So if you haven't...
Well, it's because it's a thing now, you know? Like, poor Paul.
We're all followers. We're just following Luis's lead. So, I mean, that's the thing. Yeah, yeah. So it's a great Magic TV. If you haven't had a chance to watch it, take a look at it. The top eight's amazing because I totally flub one of the picks. Like, I'm like, hey, number four is blank, blank, blank. And then all of a sudden, Paul's like,
that's not number
yeah,
four.
Yeah, dude, that's number three. And I'm like, awkward. So, all right. But
and then once you say number three, no one cares about number four then.
Yeah, so. Yeah. You know, it's like no one's listening anymore. One of the things we did talk about, which was great, was this new team series. We talked about different teams. Of course, Paul's on a team. Paul's a member of Channel Fireball Fire, Team CFB Fire. And so it kind of locked him up a bit because Marshall was digging deep. Marshall was really asking some great questions about what the dynamic of the team series that Wizards is now promoting did to testing groups. You know, all of us realize, particularly those of us who may be a little bit older, those of you watching maybe a little older, when you take something that's kind of for fun that you're doing with friends, and we're talking about professional Magic now, and you start to inject money into it, money into the decision-making process,
and
very directly into who you're playing with, who you're going to put on that piece of paper with you because you're banking on their performance over the whole season, it becomes a real test. And
all of that, like you mentioned, go ahead, let's finish.
No, go ahead. No. That was my thought.
I was just going to say, like you mentioned earlier, how it starts to test friendships even, like, and I think that's 100% true. Like, you have to, because like six players per team is not a lot. So you're going to end up being like, I'm sorry, we don't have room on our team because we went with someone who's less of a friend, but a little bit better at the game. And it's like this, it's a weird tension, you know, that's never been really present in Magic because it's like, well, you know, the Pantheon, like, we can just add another guy because there's no penalty, right? Like, so, oh, you're looking for a team. Yeah, you're good enough to go on the team, so we'll just add you, you know? Like, you've never had to limit yourself to X amount of players.
And, you know, the other question is, if you had, you know, 10 guys and gals you were testing with or 8 guys and gals you were testing with, whose name, you know, makes it?
Yeah,
it's like, yeah, I'm sorry, Frank. We're going with Hunter instead. He's just a better pick. He's a better player, and you know,
you're not wrong.
Yeah, we're comfortable going with Hunter. You're still part of the team in the sense that we're going to test together.
Yeah, and then spirit. Together.
Yeah, but we're going to back Hunter on this one. 100% the right play.
He's going to be the sixth profile in the, you know, the daily MTG article. So
I mean, you know, and he'd absolutely be a fan favorite. Let's face it, you know. So, but I think there was a lot of that happened. There was, I mean, I will tell you from the other side of this, you know, obviously Channel Fireball, we're sponsoring two teams, a lot of politics that went into this. It was very, very interesting. And a lot of what has been a friendly relationship, I think among the pro players when determining teams and who's playing with whom started to take on more of a business edge. So it was a little bit scary. Paul did a great job kind of very, very judiciously skirting the issue. And frankly, I will be very candid, CFB Fire, they were very easy to work with. And I think they held it together really, really well. As did CFB Ice. CFB Ice did a great job. So both those teams, I thought, were very, very professional about how they did things. But I just the landscape and hearing other chatter, I can see that a lot of friendships were tested in this. That being said, I think it's a really
I can imagine. I can.
That being said, I think it's a really good thing. You know, it's a growing pain. We reset the norm. We say, okay, this is how we're going to go from here on out. And it's been massively successful for esports in general. And if Magic the Gathering wants to make a move in that direction, which I wholeheartedly support, I think it's a good thing. So.
Yeah, I agree with you. I think having a team, like, Magic wants to compete in the esports arena, and, like, not having a team dynamic like this was one of the biggest hurdles, I think. Like, you can't be a legitimate, like, esport, quote-unquote, without having a way to, you know, monetize teams, you know? Mm-hmm. Like, and before this, it was all independent. Like, hey, you know, Channel Fireball has their own team, you know, but, you know, it's just Channel Fireball making that team. And now anyone with a 6-man team can register and, like, be, you know, in the running for an actual monetary prize, which is a big deal.
I agree. And it's, you know, the funny thing is unofficial teams and even official teams in the sense of team events when they used to let you name yourselves have been around since the inception of the Pro Tour, since the inception of Magic. I mean, there's old school teams like, you know, ABU, Alpha Beta Unlimited, Team CMU, which was named after Carnegie Mellon University, Antarctica, trying to think, Your Move Games, right?
Yep.
The Phoenix Foundation, which was the Kai Bud team. There were so many like iconic teams in historically in Magic that were out there, that were together. And then, of course, you know, that's kind of the older school. In the modern era, Team Channel Fireball was a thing. And part of that, frankly, was I was always enchanted with these old teams. I followed them. I thought it was great. And you'd read articles back on the Dojo days and then Meridian.
Yeah, and those guys were, back then, those guys were the best of the best.
Oh, totally.
And it's funny because I think nowadays, there are just more good Magic players than there were back then. Like, back then, there was, like, 20 guys that were just at the top of the game ever. You know, it's like, now it's like, it's closer to 50 to 60, I'd say.
Well, you know, I think that there's, you know, 50 people that you maybe put at any one time out there. In terms of top of the game, though, you got to say, like, Owen Turnwald is at the top of the game. I mean, it's hard to say anything beyond that. I really think he's probably the best player in the world, and your odds on to win a Pro Tour, to spike a Pro Tour, I'd want to just back Owen. But it's interesting because I see finally Wizards of the Coast really kind of making teams official and pushing that, kind of cyclical in the sense that I think teams were super important back in the day, not for monetizing purposes in the sense that there are now, but because that's who you tested with. There was no Magic Online. There wasn't the proliferation of information through things like channelfireball.com then that there are now. It was who you tested with, who you knew with your LGS. And that's why, like, stores like ABU and YMG were huge. CMU, Carnegie Mellon University, because the people on that team all went to CMU. So,
yeah,
who you knew, what you had in common. So it's
kinda... Is there a way for maybe, like, future PTs we can create team Channel Fireball president and CEO John Sasso? Because that seems like a sweet team.
Team Sasso. Hey, one day, you know, Channel Fireball president and CEO John Sasso and I used to talk all the time. And I mentioned this last week on Magic TV about the year the dreams come true, where we just pitch everything, take a year off work, and just grind like crazy to get on the Pro Tour. For John, it'd be a return to the Pro Tour. For me, it'd be a first-time Pro Tour. John would probably make it. I probably would not. But it would be insane. It'd be insane to do that. And then, yes, then we could have team Channel Fireball president and CEO John Sasso. But
probably, that's like, also a mouthful. I couldn't
be.
Even say
team,
it.
Team CFB PA CEO JS.
That's it.
We'd shorten it to that. Just make it easy for everyone.
Which is, come on, let's all be honest, that's significantly shorter.
It would be awesome, too. It would be awesome if our logo was just this, a huge headshot of Channel Fireball president and CEO John Sasso, just like, oh God, that would be so great. He's going to love it. I hope you're watching right now, Sass. If he's watching, it's going to be great. So, all right. That is our... I shudder to think that that's a preview in any way, shape, or form of the Pro Tour, since I think we've spent more time on coffee talk than anything else. Frankly, we spent probably equal time talking about Copycat and Fires of Yavimaya. But that is our Magic TV for the week, and that leaves us with this week's Top 8.